Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to another episode of Let's Build, and today we're going to explore a bit of the UDK, or Unreal Development Kit. This is something that I only recently just got into, pardon me, I'm getting my words mixed up, and I found this to be a very interesting piece of software. I love the Unreal Engine in general because they've made some fantastic games with fairly realistic graphics, I must say, so it's a very impressive engine overall. And they released their UDK a number of years ago, I think about 5 years, I'm still going, I think. And after they fixed out a few bugs, I've managed to just spend a little bit of time playing around with this. And so far, I'm actually quite impressed. So we're going to have a play around this. We're not going to do any programming and such because I'm not a coder. I don't know how to do that. But I will spend the next hour or so just creating some assets for this particular software. And for those who don't know, I'm actually trying to just have a play around with various game software game engines to see the possibilities of doing some machinima, okay? Well, custom-made machinima. All right, and as always, we're going to begin with a music playlist. So my selection today is, no pun intended, but 1 hour epic music by Mark Petrie, Volume 1. So let's have a play around with this. I haven't heard this before, so just let's, I guess, give it a go. Maybe I have in the past, but I don't really remember it. So I thought I'd spend a little bit of time just discussing a few things about the various game engines that I've had a chance to play around with. Again, I'm not a pro at any single one of them. I just know enough to get myself around and just explore a little bit. So I played around initially with the Unity engine. And I want to give you my opinions. This is just my personal opinion. But the Unity engine, I wanted to make some low-poly animations with this thing, rendering in real time. But I found the graphics are a little bit lacking, a little lackluster. And although this is a great engine to have a play around with, especially if you're going to create some mobile games or browser games, it kind of didn't do it for me at the time. But it's a great engine. Needless to say, so feel free to go ahead and take a look at it. The next one I took a look at was the Source Engine, and I've played a lot of their games, fantastic games, and it's not to say the engine's bad in itself, but it was a little bit limiting in terms of its graphical capabilities. I have had a play around with some of the SDK material. I found it to be very complicated to get into. It was very tweaky. You have to download a lot of programs to get started. It might be different now. This was a number of years ago, by the way, so it might be a bit easier to use these days. But I just didn't get into it personally. Although the one good perk that I found for the Source Engine is the Source Filmmaker, which they released, I think, about a year ago. And the Source Filmmaker essentially uses the Source Engine. You can use in-game maps, characters, pretty much anything to create a variety of different movies. And I found it to be fantastic. I was using this for a bit. It was easy to learn. The only problem was importing your own custom assets. Just the same way that the Source Engine was a little bit hard for me to get into is the same reason why I didn't want to use this. Because it just took too long for me to learn how to use that. And there were just too many hoops for me to jump into. But if you want to get into the Source Engine or Source Filmmaker, feel free to go ahead and take a look at that. Definitely worth checking out. And the most recent one before I started playing around the UDK was the Cry Engine. And just hands down, it's the best looking engine out there right now. I don't think I could name any other engine that can, that has the same graphical capabilities as the Crysis Engine. Or the Cry Engine, I can't even call it properly. But fantastic engine. I did have a few episodes of Let's Build playing around with this as well. And just in case you're wondering why am I doing so many different things, it's because I'm still in the middle of research and development for a slightly larger project. So I am just playing around with it, and I just want to give you my personal opinions. I found CryEngine to be fantastic to use. The code-wise, I didn't, like I said, I'm not a coder, but from initial looks, it looks pretty simple, fairly high level. You can get into it fairly easy, I would imagine. So the scripting, I don't think it would be too difficult for most of us. So unless you know C++, I think if you want to make a game, you can be a newbie and get straight into this. The only reason why I didn't want to get into this is because the licensing. There's a few licensing issues that I have. I think it's not to say the CryEngine's bad, it's just that I guess the developers want to narrow down to very specific type of clients. So if you're the average Joe and want to create games, you would find you'd have to jump through a lot of hoops in terms of the licensing. I didn't look at it in detail, but I just take a look at it and I guess make a decision. It may be fine for you, but for me, I found that they didn't want to give a lot of freedom to, you know, just the average consumer out there. So creating mods for the CryEngine may be a little bit harder, I guess. So that's my personal opinion. You may have a different one. And the other thing that kind of annoyed me was the way they've created the editor. Although it's a great editor, I found that the DRM, I think, it just narrowed down the consumer base, because if they're, you know, if their servers are down, then you can't really work on your projects. And I was just wondering, why would you do that to your own, to the public? I don't know. I guess it's the developer's decision. Maybe they'll change it down later in the future, but for now, I think I just have to skip over the CryEngine for the moment. But great engine to get into. And then I decided to play around the UDK. Overall, licensing, very free, very flexible. Go ahead and take a look at it. I think hands down UDK is by far probably the best out there. And just seeing how many games that are coming out these days using the Unreal Engine is probably a testament to how flexible they are. So I would suggest you stay with the UDK if you were to go with the game. If you wanted to create games and such, go to the UDK. That's my recommendation anyway. But I'm not here to make games. I can't make games. I don't have any experience in that. I create animations and assets and 3D low poly stuff that, like what you see right here. So again, I do want to point out, I've only played around with this for a few days. I know how to get around with just the very bare basics, so I don't feel confident enough to create any tutorials. So if you want to learn how to use the UDK, there are so many tutorials out there. I just go on YouTube and have a play around. I might create my own just to show you a much broader range of workflow, for example, creating assets from start to finish, or maybe learning how to create your animated characters and such. So that's probably what I'll focus on. I think I mentioned before that I'm not going to do small little tutorials. I'm going to do more large, broadly based tutorials where it helps you get from start to finish. Okay, so what you see right here, these assets were created, I created just recently. I have more assets, but I haven't consolidated them into UDK yet. These were just stuff that I decided to create just to have a play around to see what the editor is capable of. And overall, I have to say, creating your own assets and importing them into UDK, piece of cake. It's amazing how fast you can work with this. I personally like this, like the way to work that way. I personally like to work that way because you don't have to worry about, you know, downloading external plugins for your Maya and setting everything up. You just go ahead. If you've got Maya and you've got UDK, you're pretty much set to go to start creating your custom assets. Of course, you need your Photoshop and Mudbox to do sculpting or texturing, whatever. Okay, so I guess just to, you know, keep going, we're going to create some assets, maybe a variety of different assets to put into this scene right here. So the barrel is, what you see right here, that's the barrel. You can see the barrel here as well. Great little, you know, just model, just threw it in. Very simple textures, simple metal material, nothing special in that regard. And I don't even have a concept art for that, so I just, you know, created a cylinder, extruded it, mapped it out, and started the basic texturing. But we're going to create a new one. Let's start again, so we can at least get a feel of, I guess, our general workflow. Alright, so I think for this one, I think I might create some planks of wood that make up a floor. So one of the things that makes UDK so great is that you can create modular assets. In my case, a modular asset is you create large pieces of objects or doodads that you can just sort of paste together as prefab objects within UDK, okay? So you can, for example, you can, select a bunch of these. Actually, let's just make it make sense. So say you want to create a bunch of barrels. So instead of, you know, dragging and dropping one barrel one by one and automatically doing that, you can just set them up the way you want. And just right click and go to create prefab, wherever it is. And then you can go ahead and create a prefab. And what that does is it groups them together into one group node, and then you can just drag and drop that group node anywhere to essentially duplicate this, okay? So a very, very useful feature in, I think most game engines can do that now using prefabs. But you want to model your environment based on a fairly modular kind of a workflow. So we're going to start with something very simple, just to help. I guess if you're learning and you want to know more about creating assets for your games, then this might help actually. So I'm not going to go ahead and create any concept art. This is going to be very simple. Most of us already know how to model very simple objects like planks of wood. So that's going to be what I'm going to do. But I want this to be quite old, so one other thing I do need to put is to, I just want to put a height reference here. So this is the height of a character within the UDK or Unreal Engine, okay? So I've created this. This is a rough guide, by the way. It's not exact, so I'm going to create planks of wood based on that somewhat. So because this is an individual who's going to be walking across this. Alright, so that's our first plank of wood. I'm going to start by, creating the UV map to this. Let's clean up this area for a bit. And one other thing I do need to point out is you should have really, really good naming conventions for your objects, okay? So I'm going to put STA for static objects. And let's put floor. Okay. Four modules. And in here, I'll create a subfolder, and I'm going to call this floor modules. This is my naming convention, by the way. So floor modules, and I better check. Okay, so original, and all right, great. My apologies, I get lost sometimes. So floor modules, wood, bridge, old, or just call it wood bridge, and O1. So I'm going to copy that name convention right there. And let's save this out. Pardon me, one sec while I just clean up something. Where was it? There we go. I just realized I had two of those naming things, but I wasn't sure. Okay, so floor modules, let's save it here, and wood bridge 01, let's save this out. Okay. I'm going to keep it fairly square, so something like that. So for this module 01, and I'm going to put a postfix called plank 01. Okay. I'm going to create another one. Oops. There we go. So this is going to be the, the rung. And I want this to be fairly old, so I don't want it to be worn down. I just want it to be to look old enough to, where people can go, oh, cool, it's very, it's an oldish kind of a bridge. Very, very simplistic. So this down here. I should probably move this up as well. Hope you're enjoying this music, guys. I know it's very epic sounding, I guess. I'm going to leave a bit of a tab like that. So, woodbridge plank. Call this the woodbridge. Order. Great. I'll put one more. This is going to be the struts that kind of hold the bridge up. And if you notice, you probably notice I'm not actually too worried about trying to get all these pieces, you know, exact the way I wanted. You can if you want. It depends on, you know, how you like to work. In my particular case, I don't really care about that, so I just want to get this looking fairly decent. Okay, so that's those are our shapes so far. So it's 11:14 a.m. right now. Hopefully by 12 we'll be able to get this finished. But I'll go as quickly and efficiently as I can. So I'm going to call this... I don't even know, what do you call this stuff? Pillar? It doesn't matter, it's not going to reflect too much in the rest of the scene. Alright. So just taking a look at everything, it's looking good so far. Let me actually change this. Maybe that way. Yeah, that'll do. And because it is a game engine, you want to save as many polygons as possible. Depending on what you want, you can go ahead and delete the bottom face down here. You know, every polygon counts, just about. It's up to you if you want to do that. I'm going to do that anyway because I don't really need it in the first place. But I'm just checking, make sure this is all good. Okay, great. Alright, so I'm going to go ahead and freeze the transformations of all of these pieces. Let's group this up together. So Control-G, and the group is going to be centered, or the pivot point is going to be centered on the origin right there. Okay, so holding D, holding X, and just dragging it to the center right there. So these objects, I think I can move them up a bit. Because remember, UDK will always have the pivot point on the origin, so you want to sort of work with UDK. Now, I know that that's the height reference, but that's alright, I was just using it as a general guide. Alright, so the next thing I want to do is start mapping out these UVs. Because they are very messy, because I just screwed it up big time. And I want to do the UVs first before I... Because it is going to be old, I'm going to add some extra divisions just to mess it up a little bit, but I'm going to do the UVs first because it helps me, you know, avoid those problems a little bit later. So in my case, I'm going to go ahead and cut. So cut the areas here. And let's make a cut right there. Brilliant. Then we'll select our UVs. I'm going to select two of them, which is these two, and just unfold. Okay, so this will give us our very, very nice looking plank right here. Now, to save space and use as much of this UV space as possible, I'm going to make cuts on these edges. Just slice them open. And then I'll select those two edges and sew them together so that they're... I'll do the top. On the top part. So we'll hide the seam on the bottom. So this is the bottom face, that's a top face. Let's sew that up. And that way we can use more space. Alright, so the plan, what I'm doing here is I'm going to create a variety of different planks here. So I'm going to start with the top. There's going to be three different kinds, I guess. So we'll put one up there. Duplicate again. 2, 3. And for this one, we will push it down. Same with this one. So we'll push it down. Okay, great. Essentially, what I'm trying to do is, you know, use up as much space as I can. And I might actually shrink this down. I may make a fourth one just to be certain. And we'll put it down here. So these are four variants. Essentially, this is like a prefab, if you know what I mean. It just helps me establish, or it just helps me create textures a little bit quicker, or variants of textures a bit quicker, so we don't have to create a separate plank material for each one. This just saves space and files, so the simpler you can make it, the better. I'm going to do the same with this one, so let's go ahead and do planar mapping. I always do planar mapping because I'm going to keep everything in one shape. I don't like working with separate faces, but it doesn't matter. It's up to you how you want to work. So for this one, I'll do the same thing. Gonna make the cut on the bottom there. Just make the top here. Like so. Let's make a cut. Beautiful. From here, we'll... I guess we'll have a play around with the... Nope, that's not good. Sorry. Let me just move this out of the way. And... beautiful. So that's the top. Should have made the cut over here. That's how we'll do the cut. And then we'll do the sew. Again, I'm trying to be consistent with everything else here. Okay. So I've got the top face, side, bottom. That's alright. Now I can just plug it right here. Okay. And lucky last, we will do this one. Let's do planar mapping. Let's go to my edges and... and let's go ahead and fix this up. So for this one might be a bit trickier, but what am I doing? I think that's right. Okay, so there's no face on the bottom, which is great. So make a slice right there, and let's go ahead and unfold. Beautiful. So that's our front. Yeah, we did that wrong. Sew that up. Perfect. So yeah, overall, my impressions of the UDK, or the Unreal Engine, very, very good. I'm very, very pleased with what is offered for people in general. People, I guess, developers like you and me. And we want to, you know, all we really want to do is create video games, create really cool video games. That's what we want. We don't want any of that nonsense licensing. And as like, I'm not against licensing at all. Like, no, I'm all for it. Like, companies have to make money and such, of course, sure. And the thing that I don't like is when, I guess, when developers make it hard for us to, you know, get creative. It's just hard for people in general to, you know, express themselves through their video games or their machinima or whatever it is they need. So I'm definitely all for the licensing, but it'll just be really good if developers in general could open up more possibilities by, I guess, giving us a bit more freedom. Valve certainly has done really well in that regards. If you don't know, you can actually monetize the animations you make using their assets, like Team Fortress and such. You can go ahead and, you know, make a profit out of it if you want, for sure. And Unreal Engine, of course, Epic Games. I keep getting it wrong. Epic Games. They've got the idea as well. They've, you know, given creative people like me enough freedom where, you know, everyone can be happy. They can turn over profits just by giving us reasonable licensing. And I want you know, companies to make money, for sure. Like, everyone's trying to make a bit of cash on the side. It's just great when we get the freedom to do, I guess, to do what we always wanted. Alright. Okay, so that's the UV map all laid out. I'm thinking I might be able to fit one more, so I'm going to create a variant of this. I'll just duplicate. I'm not too worried about that. Just so that we fill up as much of that as we can, okay? So all this is going to be one material. Now, the great thing about this is you can go ahead and duplicate these using the same materials and flip it over, turn it around to create a variant, you know? Alright, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to fix this up by turning this, making this look a little bit older than it is. So UV maps already, I should probably clear this, so let's go Shift-Alt-D just to clean it up. And don't forget to save, guys. Okay, so this is the other module right here. Okay, so I want this to be fairly old, I don't know, I guess a shipping dock kind of a floor. So I'm going to go ahead and insert some edge loops, and just break this apart ever so slightly. You don't want to do too much with it, so you don't have to make it too complicated. I'm just going to skew it ever so slightly. Now remember, even the smallest amount of deformations here, people can pick up on it, in general. So, you can go ahead and do something like this. Maybe bring it down. Again, you don't want to add too much detail, because I guess just the principle of gaming. You want to use as few polygons as possible. Because the games are, of course, they are in real time, so just keeping that in mind will help you, I guess, get really good results. Alright, so that's one. Let's do the same for this, for the other ones as well. Just to be consistent, I might try and keep the same number of what I had before. I'll also thicken this a bit. Looking great. I think in general, all of these should be a little bit fatter. The style that I'm going for is fairly cartoony, so I do want to exaggerate some of this. Just slightly, not too much, just slightly, enough so that the audience can see it. These are fairly old wood planks, so and I must apologize, guys, I haven't been keeping up to date with my tutorials and such. For a number of reasons. Firstly, I have been very busy. So I do want to keep strong in the tutorial department, but sometimes I just get a bit busy and I don't have the energy to create a tutorial that's useful for people. So I want to make sure everything I make is great, just in general. Alright, let's go ahead and create another I'll do my best to keep up to date with, I guess, everything out there happening in the market right now. And although I do work professionally, it does, you do tend to lose track of what's going on out there. Sometimes you get just inundated with client work and you need to sort of take a break or a breather. But I truly enjoy making game assets, or low poly assets. Sorry, not game assets, but I'll just call it low poly assets because I guess that encompasses everything. But I love it. It's definitely one of my favorite aspects of working. So we're gonna go ahead and create some more planks of wood. Again, this is the fourth variant. You would have noticed the, you know, it's not consistently the same. That's fine. I don't want it to be. So this one will be, I guess, an outward plank, like so. just adds a bit of noise to the wood part here. Just gives it a very nice old look, I guess. Gonna clean this up as well. Alright. Good mesh, looking good. And fairly low poly as well. Alright, for these two, I'm going to go ahead and do the same. I'm going to put one up there and put one down here. So I'll just split it twice. So for this one. Maybe just bend it slightly, like so. Give that a little bit more support. Great. Alright, good. I think these beams down here should probably remain straight overall. Maybe not. I think I'll just bend it ever so slightly. Just delineate it a tad so that we have slight imperfections to this fairly old wood. The same for this one. So this is a very generic asset, I would say. I'm not aiming to try and get, try and make it look anything specific or follow any kind of a theme. All this really is just me creating it on top of my head. Generally, whenever you're creating your assets, you want to have some kind of concept art to follow, okay? So if there's no art direction, then your assets will turn out inconsistent, okay? They will break apart and it will just look ugly in-game. So you don't want to do that. You want to make sure you're consistent with the art style. So that's what art directors are for. They tell you whether or not the asset is, following the theme of the game or the animation, whatever it may be. So that you might be going, okay, I'm creating a big giant barrel here, or a wall. And then the art director will come and say, no, that doesn't look consistent. It's a Italian Renaissance style, or it's a futuristic wall, and you've made wood walls. They don't have wood in the future. I don't know how true that is, but you get what I mean. It's just trying to be consistent with what you have and how you work. And it takes a bit of practice, of course. But the one thing that will always help you is if you have concept art to start with. So I've always had this rule, if you have no concept art, you should never start modeling in general. Okay. So unless you know which direction you want to take it, you should avoid, avoid doing that as best as you can. Now let me try and, there we go, just trying to fix this up. So one last thing I want to do is probably resize some of these a little bit. Just fixing it and make sure they sort of look a little bit different from each other. Because I did duplicate them, by the way, so it might help if I just break it apart a little bit. And the best part about making assets is that it's quite mindless or brainless. You can listen to music like what we're doing right now. Now if I was animating, I think it would be a little bit more difficult because when you're animating you actually have to think creatively constantly, but in this particular case I can do this off just muscle memory. I don't really have to think about anything, to be honest. It's a very weird, I don't know, it's very, very strange, but it, some things you can do without thinking, others you can't. But in my case, I think I'm pretty happy with this. Okay, so that's our module right here. Now remember, this is the kind of thing where you'll be duplicating it. So here's an example. So if you go into UDK, you want to duplicate, you want to just be able to tile it like that. Okay, constantly. Bang, bang. Oh, bang. That kind of a deal. So what I want to do is make sure... I'm going to delete those. What I want to do is make sure I can actually do that without worrying too much about the... Oh, I've got duplicate objects here. That's not good. Must have pressed the wrong button. Yeah, I did. Ah, pardon me. It was the group 2. Oh dear. What have I done? Yep. I screwed this up. Pardon me one sec. I must have forgotten that I had a second group right there. Okay, that's better. So we're going to make sure this is very, very modular. So in my case, I want to just fix this up. The simplest way of doing this is just to give it a bit of an overhang on the last plank right here. And for the first plank, somehow add probably half to that point. So maybe about that much. Bring this back a little bit more, just so that we have a bit more workable area there. And over here, I think I can use these two to sort of become a seam, so that it'll be quite seamless. Okay, so let's give this a test and have a play around. So it's looks quite nice. Obviously, the planks over coming on top of that. So what I want to be able to do is find some way to move this plank a bit further back. So any way I can think of is to shrink it slightly and then just move it back here. Like so. And for the end aspects of this, I might make it a little bit larger so that it also, again, it just overlaps what we see here. Now remember, it is a game asset. Sorry, it is a low poly asset, so I'm not too concerned with getting it absolutely perfect, but it does help to sort of work in that fashion. Okay, just using it as a guide, I'm gonna bring this forward then instead. And for that, I might expand it slightly, kind of like this. Delete group 2, test it out. It's 11:30, I think we're going to get straight into the texturing and hopefully we'll finish this off. So tiling wise, I'm happy with that. The music's getting into it, eh? Great, so I'll delete that, might have to change. Thing about this is I don't want to leave any gaps. I want this to be quite modular, I guess. There will be several versions of this, guys. This is just the first version. It will be the same version as the rest of it. Okay, so let's duplicate the... Oh, dear me. Duplicate this again and just put it underneath there. Maybe spin it 180 degrees. So minus 180. Same with this one. Give it a bit more support. And I'm not trying to line it up absolutely perfect, because again, I want to keep that old feel. So I'll just leave it as it is. And maybe just 180. Perfect. Great. Very happy with this. Very pleased with it. So I'm just going to... let's go to my filing name conventions, wherever it is. Where are you? Floor modules. Floor modules, here we go. Let's rename the group to be that. Okay. So overall, very, very, fairly simple to do. Let me just double check and make sure everything is clean. So I think we have to go freeze the transformations. Let's do it this way. So select all of that, freeze the transformations. Perfect. I can get rid of that reference as well, so we don't really need that. Great. Mine is bugging out a bit. Alright, so that's our module, the floor. Let's do some texturing. I'm going to grab this, go to my UV texture editor, let's go ahead and select all of them and export it out as a UV snapshot, okay? So apologies if we go over time and I run out of music, so I'll keep doing this until we're completely finished. So wooden bridge, and okay. I'm using a 2K res texture. I don't think I need any more than that, really. This was a barrel texture I had recently, so I'm going to close this off. Let's close that off as well. Alright. So in our... in our Photoshop, we'll go ahead and start texturing. So I'm going to grab the PNG right here. Now, I've already got an action macro that does this automatically, but essentially I go Shift F2 and it creates all this, you know, UV texture base ready for me to use. It just saves me a bit of time, I don't really have to worry too much about it. But you can create your own macros as well, and I guess just have a play around, see what you get. Alright, so with this... this is where things can get a little bit tricky, because now you gotta try and create nice wood texture... Sorry, a plank texture on that, but you don't want to use a low-res image, you want to use a fairly high-res image. So I might use this one. So again, I'm looking at the edges here. I'm just looking at the top, guys, so you don't have to worry if you don't know what I'm doing. We'll go ahead and... Even better, I think it's easier if I just... where's the rough wood? I might use this one, actually. Yeah, it doesn't look too old. Might stick with this one. So these textures you can get from CG Textures. I'm just reusing the ones that I downloaded for other projects. But yeah, you can certainly go ahead and grab some more. I think this wood texture is perfect, so I might get rid of that. And let's copy and paste. Oops. Sorry. There we go. I'm gonna get rid of those holes as well, because I don't think I want them there. Alright, so we've got the texture. Let's go ahead and tint it. Actually, come to think of it, I might not actually get this done by the hour, but I guess I'll do my best. Great. I'm just going to go ahead and use this for the side, or the edges. If you're new to texturing, you'll find that texturing is not that difficult if you at least understand how to just operate on the principles of your UV, sorry, operate on, you know, just exactly to your UV coordinates. It's easier to texture if you've created your own UV maps, okay? So don't freak out, just, you know, have a go, have a play around. You'll get better as you practice. Alright, that's great. I might get another piece of that very blank aspect here. And maybe just shrink it down. So that we cover the edges of that. They're fairly simple. It's a fairly simple little thing, I guess. Alright, so the top segment, I'm gonna grab another one, volume segment. so we can fit this in. See there. Expand this frame so we can get a better sense of our texture. Great. So the movement texture, I'm gonna darken it ever so slightly. Well, these two are. Oops. Oh dear me. So my stamp tool, I'm going to use the stamp tool. Unbelievable, this computer's going on. And just next to my computer is my Wacom Cintiq. I'm going to use it to fix up these holes because I don't want them there at all. They're just distracting. At least the way I feel, they are distracting for me anyway. It's okay, you can make your own decisions how you want to do your textures, but this is just my particular way of working. So I don't want those holes there at all. It's not hard to hide them, especially if you've got a photo texture. It's fairly simple. Let's do the same for this one. Now, for those who are wondering, if you want to purchase a Wacom Cintiq, and in case you don't know what that is, it's actually a screen where you can use a Wacom pen to draw on. And it feels more natural than using an actual table desktop, but my personal opinion, again, just my opinion, I would avoid buying one unless you are dedicated to doing, drawing professionally. So, personally for me, I feel that it was a bit of an overkill purchase for me. It is very expensive. Wacom Cintiqs are not cheap. They are about $2,000. About the same cost of an actual computer. So for what they do, I'd say it's very expensive to go ahead and make those purchases without thinking about your budget. But for what it does, it's very. I guess it doesn't matter whether you have a Bamboo, which is a very cheap version of a Wacom tablet, or if you have a Wacom Cintiq. They all do the same thing. It just depends how you want to work. If you prefer to work more naturally on a screen, then by all means, go ahead and do that. Alright, so that's the first one. And we've got four more. Ugh. Fantastic. But the thing we can duplicate is the edges here. Okay, because they are going to be the same. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Fantastic. Let's go ahead and grab another section. With the top section done, I'm going to do the bottom sections. Isn't texturing fun? You're creating, you're essentially coloring in your objects. At least that's what I feel whenever I'm doing this. Oh dear, I screwed this up. I didn't see my texture properly. That was silly. Let's do that again. So it's coming in this area right here. Let's cover this area. Great, let's grab another one. Fairly old kind of an asset, so I like using this particular texture because it just works so well for the effect. Let's clean the edges up on that section here. Oh dear, I keep forgetting. Up. Alright, and again, we'll just going to narrow that down. Let's just tidy this up a bit. And use my brush to cover up those holes there, because I don't want them there. They're evil. Evil, evil holes. Let's get rid of them. Texture painting is the same principle if you're going to create textures in a more painted style. So it doesn't matter whether you're using photos and such. Again, it's dependent on your art style that you want to go for. My particular case, I'm going for a fairly realistic one. It's going to be full on with some, I guess, normal maps and such. Sometimes sculpted maps if I have to, but I don't think I'm going to get to that point. At least not anytime soon, so we'll keep it as it is. Alright. May not get all of this done, but we'll do do my best for now. Let's go ahead and do this. So if you notice, I'm working fairly carefully here, because I want these assets to be final assets. I don't want to have to come back to it and fix up problems that I missed out because I was too lazy to do it during production. That's just generally the way I work. You know, other people work differently, so it's up to you. Fantastic song. I'm a real fan of epic music. It's just something that I love. Great. So let's cover this up again and fix up our holes. It's very hard for people to notice, even if you're just using a stamp tool like this, so it's okay. What really matters is just what it looks like in the end, on a more macro scale, a larger scale, so don't be too worried if it doesn't look perfect. You can try and get it looking perfect as best as you can, but I better get rid of those things as well. It's annoying. I can't believe it though, these nails are everywhere. Yep, so essentially what matters is the result in the end. People don't really care how you do it as long as you get the job done right. Alright, so we'll do one more. Something probably off the top here. Choose this one actually. Great. Fantastic. Let's take a look at one last piece on the bottom. Adding a little bit of handles here so that we don't get any problems with just some texturing, edge textures. I call them sub-pixel problems. Let's hide these nails up. Oh dear. Pardon me. clone tool, clone stab tool, whatever the thing's called. Just covering up those annoying holes. Don't want them there. Get over this piece as well, it's just a bit too large. And for this one I might fix this up a bit as well. Sorry. Great. Lose a little bit of that. You can use the healing bush if you want, guys. It's up to you. My particular side, I don't really want to do that. I'm just gonna eye it. Cover up some segments where I don't want those things to appear at all. Maybe just loosen up some of those cracks. We'll close up some of those cracks. Alright, I'm happy with that. Got a nice color scheme. Actually, I might change it. Come think of it. Not too happy with that, so we'll go ahead. I'll leave it for now, actually. Alright, so let's do the rest of it. I'll leave those layers there. Let's create a new layer. And let's fix up the bottom segments. So the bottom segments will be a little bit more dirty and mossy, I guess. So that's, I'm going to use this bottom half. Do the bottom part here first. Because this is the beam, I'm not worried about the overall look of that. So, but I am still going to use my brush, just clean up some sections that I don't think are working well. Okay, just like so. Get rid of those plants. Pardon me. Spring in Australia. So the winds are blowing, pollen is everywhere. Having a fantastic time sneezing my face off. I don't know where you guys are living, but if you ever plan to visit Australia, just beware of the hay fever. It's so rampant around us all. Great. Alright, bottom one done. I don't really care. Point anyway. Let's start doing the... I'm gonna do some color balancing with that, by the way, guys. Don't worry too much about it. Oh no, that's not good. That's not a good piece. I am hoping to do more tutorials for the UDK if I get better at it. So it is going to take a bit of time for me to get some practicing, guys. So I apologize if you don't get any tutorials from me for quite some time. I am going to try. But it will take a little bit of time for me to get my head around it completely, so... I wouldn't worry too much, because I will try to cover it as best as I can. Don't worry what you would... If you're wondering what I was doing there, don't worry. I'm just throwing some basic shapes here. This is just another part of texturing. Again, it doesn't matter how you do it. What matters is the result in the end. In my case, because I have such low res textures, I have to sort of fix it up by... Oh dear, that's not going well. I've got to fix it up by adding some extra things on top. I might have to go to another texture here. So I might grab this one. Let's just pull into Photoshop. A bit too old. I don't think I want to use that one. This one might be a little better. It's okay, I'll do some color balancing in just a moment. So for this piece, it's much better. I want the lighter part to be on top, so... I'm going to start with the bottom one first. Great. I don't want to fix this up. Too messy. So there we go. So even the clone tool right here is fantastic to use. I think we'll leave it as it is. Let me do some quick balance, color balancing. Because it is, it's a bit too... It differs too much to the other textures that I have in that scene. So I'll just lose a little bit of this. I'm using curves to try and get something that's fairly similar. It doesn't have to be, but I'll see what we can get. We're just about done. Same at the top here. I might do some tweaks after this tutorial, but I do want to get this done so that you guys can at least see the end result. So that's pretty good so far. Let me do some color balancing down here. So I don't want too much contrast. I do want to do some saturation on that. So just bring the contrast down a little bit. Sorry, bring the contrast up a little bit. And for the bottom one, for it to crush it down substantially. So that looks quite nice. This top one is very inconsistent, so I think I'm going to be hard-pressed to find a way to fix this. Technique that I'm going to do is just grab this. Just expand this up here, so. But we're going to turn this to a color, wherever that may be, color, and just the bottom, so I'm going to hide that, so just the bottom one, I'm going to turn this black and white, so we only get the values, and then we can maybe get colors on top. Okay, it's not looking that great, but... Just playing with the hue and saturation, sorry, the overlay modes. Maybe there's something that might work, maybe not. Overlay. Yeah, that might be better. I don't know. We'll see what we get. I think I'm pretty happy with that anyway, overall as a wood texture. So let's go. I'm going to save this out as a PSD. And let's preview this very quickly before we do any of the normal maps. So I'm going to go ahead and create my blin, quick blin. Again, that's a macro that I created for myself. I'm not, you know, it wasn't anything special in particular. So copy, paste that thing and texture 01. It's my personal naming convention. You can create your own. With the file, let's go and grab that particular floor module thingy. Lost my mind for a second there. File. So I'm going to create a bump mapping as well. So this little bump file. And finally, the specularity. So this will be spec file. Alright, great. So I'll just do that right there. Let's apply it to our entire mesh right here. This will either look amazing or absolutely horrible. So there you go. That's a fairly readable asset already. Again, I'm going to have to adjust some of this, but right now what I want to do is go ahead and play around with some of the normal maps, which I'm going to do right now. Wherever Photoshop is, right there, right in front of my face. Let's go ahead and merge the posts. Oh dear, base is not in the right place. So I'm going to close everything else off. And using Endo 2, we'll create our normal maps, okay? And finally, we'll also do our specular maps as well. And I think the music's already over. I'll just replay a little bit. Because the music's great anyway. So with the normal maps, you can either sculpt it in Mudbox manually, that's usually better, or ZBrush, that's usually better for very, very thick, I guess, rock, okay? So if you want to, sometimes have to manually sculpt that. But in our case, our surface is quite flat, so we can use Endo 2 to create our normals, okay? So to use this, you just select the merge post, in my case, it's that. I'm going to go to presets, and I'm just going to go to soft spectrum and active dock. And this will take a minute or two, depending on how big the texture is. This is a 2K texture, so it won't take too long. But anything higher than 2K, then you'll expect it to sort of increase in the amount of processing time it'll take. So far it's been a fun little project so far. I think we did one asset in about an hour, but keeping in mind this is a very generic asset. There was no need for concept art, and the actual UV layout was actually very simple. So in that regard, it's not too bad. But if you want to create more complicated assets, then it's going to take you a little bit longer to do. So just keep that in mind whenever you are working on your projects. But I'm quite happy with what we've got so far. It's looking quite nice. Hopefully we'll bring this into UDK before we finish off, just so that you guys can see what it looks like. And this is taking much longer than it should. I don't know if that's right. It might actually be because of the presets. Some presets have far more settings, so... Some presets have more settings to process, so I guess it depends on which one you want to use. Okay, so those are our barrels right there. That's our torches, which I haven't created a particle system for. Very basic crate. Okay, we're about to bring in the... I don't know what this thing is called. I just call it floor. So, about to bring in our floor and see what we get. Alright, Endo 2, don't fail me now. Come on. Brilliant. I think, yeah, there's a lot of tiny things down here. Okay, so you've got your preview right here. Okay, and you can hold right click mouse button, hold Alt, then click to rotate, pan this around, and you can just check your normal maps. That's a little bit too much, so I'm going to turn just the majority of the stuff down. Again, you want to have a play around with these settings. If you're not sure how your normal map is supposed to look like, then go ahead and take a look at some photos online just to see what it looks like in general in real life. Oops. But I'm quite happy with that. I'm going to leave it as it is. Alright, now I can close out Endo 2. Let's copy paste this normal in here. It's great. Finally, I'm going to duplicate this and create a specular map. Specular map helps just bring the colors out where they should. So in my case, the funny thing about a specular map is I want to keep some of the colors there because this is a wood kind of a grain. Maybe not too much, just bring the saturation down after we've crushed the blacks. Hopefully this will turn out a lot better than it looks. Okay, so that's our specular map. Very simple. Some people like to use a black and white specular map, okay? You can if you want, up to you. But what I've done is I've made a mental note of how I want this to look, so... It takes a bit of practice to know the values that you want to apply to your settings right here, guys, so... You just have to give it play around with it until you get something that you like. Might bring out the specularity a lot more so that we have a nice vivid color. Alright, so all we want to do now is save the PNGs to separate filing names. And we can bring this back into Maya, have a final check, and then bring this into our UDK as a final asset. One thing I haven't covered is the collision mode and low poly... I don't even know what you call it. Level of detail. I have to take a look at the documentation. I haven't looked at that yet, so hopefully I'll get some time over the next couple of weeks to check it out. And okay, so that's our specularity save. Let's save our normal map. So this is my naming convention, just putting N as the postfix there. So hopefully I'll be able to do more tutorials on UDK in general. I don't think I'll be able to cover code and such, because like I said, I'm not a coder. I don't know how to make games, so it's better if you check out some tutorials later. I might do some research and give it a go, but I don't think that's something that I want on my agenda at this point, because just learning these things is very, very difficult by itself already. So I want to focus my attention on very specific, specialized areas. All right, so we've got that down. Let's go into Maya. And this is very important. I've got three nodes right here. You want to use the PNG files, okay? So I'm going to put the specularity right there, and finally the normal map. Don't forget to change it to tangent space normal so that you can see. And let's go to my renderer and check it out in viewport 2.0. So we can see our amazing bump map and specular thingy, or whatever it is you want to call it. So that's our point light system. Okay. Very readable. Looks fantastic. I think we're pretty much done. Alright. Great. Alright, so I'm gonna save this out. Now the way you wanna do this, I haven't done this with multiple objects before, so apologies if I get this wrong, but you want to export this out as an FBX, so you select the group in my case, and I'm going to just use the same naming convention. So FBX, and save. Now don't forget, guys, just be aware of the version of your FBX exporter. If you have an older version and it won't import into UDK, then you should head over to I think Autodesk or something, and update your exporter, okay? So right now what I'm using is the 2013.3. Maybe I don't have it, but that's alright. So just be aware of your version, okay? Here we go, about. Okay, so 2013, that's what you want to use with the latest UDK at this point. So I'm going to export this out as an FBX. And this is great because you don't need to use any other exporters. Once it's out on FBX, just go to your content browser in your UDK. So say, for example, you've already created a custom library. I'm just going to import. Go to my... where is it? Floor modules. And let's import the FBX. And if all goes well, you should be able to just... Well, one other thing you want to make sure is make sure you import materials right here, okay? So just go, okay, and let UDK do the rest. It will, I think it does all the compiling within itself, and then it saves it into its own UDK pack. And then I think it might take a while, so we're just about done, guys. Finish it up on a high note so that we can see what the asset looks like in our UDK editor right here. Too sure how long it takes, but it shouldn't take too long. Okay, great. So that's our asset. Oh, dear me. I have a problem already. Seems like it's not going to... Ah, alright, I see. I see the problem, guys. Let's delete this. So delete force, yes to all. Apparently, you have to combine them, so they're all separate right now, so you have to combine them into one mesh. I'm just going to combine it. Very, very simple. There's nothing too hard about that. Get rid of it right here. Let's just type history. So one. Alright, let's try this again. So I'm going to export the selection. Save as the same FBX file. Very strange. It's no big deal. It just means you'll have to separate these manually, or you keep a separate file with all the meshes, I guess, and do that manually. Fix it if you want to make changes. But generally, You don't want to do that. You want to make sure everything's correct before you start importing anything. So I'm going to import that once more. Hopefully this won't take as long. So I guess I learned something new today. Apparently you can only do it, you can't keep it in groups. You might have to combine all the meshes together. Take a while. I'm not sure how long it will take. It shouldn't take too long. Theoretically, it should work now. So I apologize if it doesn't, but like I said, I'm still learning this. I'll get my head around with it. Okay, that's much better. Okay, so we've only got one mesh. We've got our materials right here. Specularity thingy, that blue thing, whatever it is, and our textures right here. So let's drag this in and see what we have. So that's our wood asset, looking beautiful, just as I predicted. Yeah, right. So, hope you guys have enjoyed this series. This is, I've screwed that up. Hope you guys are enjoying this series. I enjoy making them. They are very raw tutorials, but like I said, it's just a live stream style event, I guess. So, I'm just held alt, and what I can do is just pull it back like so. I'm trying to get my head around how to navigate these areas here. It is a bit tricky, a bit difficult for me to sort of get my head around. But it's not too bad once you understand it. So let's go ahead and build this up, and I think we'll finish off right here. So when you're building, essentially you are rendering all the light maps. So the light maps are being baked into the level itself. It helps give you a nice look to the level. Because right now it's all simulated, but once you put all this stuff in, you'll see you get some ambient occlusion, much nicer shadows and such. And it'll just look much better overall. Yeah, I'm guessing this will take quite some time because there's so much happening here. I'm going to ignore those messages because I have no idea what they all mean. But as far as we can see, so you've got nice, well, fake ambient occlusion, I think. And overall, I'm quite pleased with this. Alright, guys. Hope you've enjoyed this very strange, cumbersome tutorial. As always, if you like this content, please subscribe. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you guys next time with a slightly better tutorial than what I've made here, but I'm really happy with this so far. Look at this. I can build a whole level in like 50 days or something. Oh dear. So yeah, leave any comments, critiques in the comment section below, and let me know if you guys have any requests, particular requests for any tutorials that you want to see. Alright, I'm going to keep playing around this for a bit more. Alright guys, see you guys around. You know, I can duplicate these things. Make it bigger. Create like a loading dock. So beautiful.